Thank you so much, Dave. And indeed, ladies and gentlemen, we are reaching the culmination point of this event. It's the tippity top of the mountain currently. My name is Maxman, and today I'm going to be joined by the one and only amazing Excoundrel. It's been a while, Excoundrel, but we are here for the finals of the Asia Brawls. Couldn't get any better than that.
Yeah, I think these two teams have clearly shown that they are the strongest in our competition, especially that big run that NextPlay made through the lower bracket. I am thoroughly impressed with them. I think they obviously were in the finals of the previous tournament. They are now in the finals of the second tournament, and they are definitely proving their worth as one of the best teams in the Philippines.
Yeah, last time they did lose against 16-bit, but there's no 16-bit in their way today. But anyways, now we're going to be putting our focus onto the draft. Olaf and also Braum banned away from this one. Braum, not a character you see banned away all that much, but Olaf, he's a pretty busted character, as I like to say. He's pretty high up there when it comes down to the tier list of Wild Rift. Now, big engage potential coming out from Omega Esports. They got Lee Sin and Camille. Their potential to single out a target is going to be extremely high, especially when you're up against a Jhin. If he gets focused down and ultimate, like, ulted by that Camille, like, Jhin is going to struggle pretty heavily, but Alistar does counter that Camille to be able to negate that ultimatum at the end.
Yeah, I think obviously you ban Braum for this particular reason if you want to very early rotate Alistar. I mean, Alistar is an S tier support in the meta right now, absolutely. Like, there are very few supports that are as good as Alistar, but Braum is one of those few picks that actually deals with Alistar relatively well. And also, Braum is a direct counter into Jhin, too. So I'm assuming this is a Braum ban because A, they wanted to play Jhin, and B, they wanted to play the Alistar. So that's kind of knocking out two birds with one stone. The Camille offers you, as you said, like really good engage, but also gives you that extra sort of bow string to your bow in the sense that you're looking for a split push technique. You know, you've got the ability to split push very effectively with Camille whilst retaining some ability to interact in team fights and be relatively useful in those team fight scenarios. But it is also a very strong top lane pick in general right now, has a lot of good matchups. This is very classic NextPlay, though, by the way. This is the composition that you've seen them run over and over and over again. It is the 1-3-1. You get them the Zed and the you get the Zed and the Akali rolling into like a super strong side lanes in both sides. You know, they look to 1v1 anybody. This is a super classic NextPlay.
Yeah, big dive potential coming out from next play in this one. They're like, Jhin's just going to be trying their best to dive onto the back line, make their way onto the Kai'Sa if possible. But I do like the Janna pickup overall. That one's going to try and create a lot of room and a lot of breathing space for the rest of Omega Esports to try and really peel away for the rest of the team. And Fiora is going to be the last pickup here. You were talking about split push potential. Fiora, I would also say, does fit in that kind of category. So I think that both teams have kind of similar idea of like trying to commit to those split pushes.
This is
overall, the draft is now done.
Camille mid, Max. It's either Fiora mid or Camille mid here. It's one of the two. This is interesting. I mean, they're very heavy AD damage for one. Obviously, they're kind of nothing really coming from their roster giving you much AP damage whatsoever. But I think they've gone for the Fiora because they've realized that this is the classic NextPlay 1-3-1 style comp where you have the Zed and the Akali, and Chuli on the Zed is an absolute monster. So they've basically said, okay, we need to match you in the side lanes because we don't want to get torn apart in a 1v1. And they've drafted two strong split push side laners. So these two comps, neither of them are team fight compositions. I would say that NextPlay can team fight slightly better. Zed and Akali function better in team fights, I would say, than the Camille and the Fiora especially. But this is two compositions that have drafted two strong solo laners in the attempt to essentially form 1-3-1 comps. So instead of trying to go for like a hard engage or an Orianna or something to give them the kind of the power in the teamfight scenarios, they've actually just said, we're going to match you in solo lane strength and we're going to beat you in the side lanes.
The split push category is going to be coming up for Omega Esports. Very interesting draft, but also if you guys are not too familiar, that means that all of these characters picked by these two teams will not be available for the remaining section of this PO7. Unless we do go to a game 7, then another rule applies completely. We'll go through that if indeed it does happen, but 7 games might be happening today and it's going to be a pretty intense one. But ladies and gentlemen, game 1 of the PO7 finals of the Wild Rift Asia Brawl Grand Finals is about to occur and is going to be Omega Esports versus NextPlay Esports. The Filipino Finals, as I like to say, the Pinoy Finals, and only one team will prevail. And also, in terms of cash prize, we do have some pretty big discrepancies overall. The team that ends up in number one position will get $100. And the second position team, the one that loses this matchup today, will be taking home $500. So still some pretty big money when it comes to the early days of Wild Rift Competitive, but there's still a lot more to come in the future. And this draft is going to be fun. But in terms of draft specifically, like Scandrel, I usually like to ask, which draft do you like? Would you like to give the edge to here? Like, which one do you prefer the most?
Personally, I prefer the next play draft for two reasons. A, they have that flexibility of being able to function in a teamfight scenario where they can bring Chuli, they can bring Arisen in on the Akali and the Zed, and they can actually still go for a backline dive, blow people up relatively easily. It's a little bit more difficult for Fiora and Camille to do the same thing. Whereas Zed and Akali can actually jump into a teamfight if necessary and, you know, obviously look for that execution onto the Kai'Sa, onto the Janna, or even the Lee Sin if they really wanted to. The other reason is, this is the comp that next play Hail Mary a lot of the time. Like, a lot of when the chips are down, we saw Arisen on the Akali, we saw Chuli on the Zed, and it pretty much won all the time for them. Like, it was like almost a 100% win rate draft for them. They have come out big in the first game of this best of seven. But remember, they need to win this because these are some very, very big power picks for this team. We are in, obviously, all-round ban pick, so they will never get access to these champions again unless we go all the way to the end into a best of seven. So this is essentially a game where they're throwing down the gauntlet and saying, Max, we're going to win this game. This is our opening game. We're going to win it because we've picked a very comfortable composition for ourselves.
I mean, they did very similar yesterday against Chakaimuka. Like, a lot of big characters early on, and then unfortunately when their big picks were gone, they were like, well, now Chakaimuka are doing a comeback two games in a row, and they struggled pretty heavily, so hopefully they can keep the steam roll going. Some deep vision coming on through from the Janna, making sure that they know that the Vite is indeed kicking off on the Raptors, so they can try and predict a little bit that jungle rotation. In the bot lane, though, the matchup is going to be Alistar and Jhin, which is a combo that I appreciate a lot, even though he doesn't have the new sexy skin on the event, so I'm very unfortunate there. And up against Smart, and also Strongans is going to be there also, with the Janna and the Kai'Sa, which once again is going to be some great peeling potential. Janna does pretty damn good into an Alistar with that Tornado. So the game is going to be off to a good start. While Vi try to go for Sneaky Low Invade into the jungle to maybe snatch away the red, but unfortunately nothing shall come from it.
She's going to use the Vision Cone to just essentially try and scout out any vision, clear it from the river, make sure that she's got a relatively safe approach for when the Rift Scuttler spawns. What I find interesting, though, is that Vi is on the same side of the map as the Lee Sin. She's essentially throwing the gauntlet down to the Lee Sin to say, I am happy to fight you for the River Scuttler, which is very interesting. You would not expect a Vi to try and go for this kind of early River Scuttler contest, but it looks like next play want nothing. Omega want nothing to do with this. They're just backing off. They're saying, okay, we're fine. We know that the Akali is relatively strong at level 3. We're not going to try and take this fight. We're just going to go trade for the other River Scuttler.
I think the other River Scuttler is actually going to be a lot more impactful. Reason why is you're going to be also having that Drake coming up very, very soon. So you want to try and keep information on that one. Rotation towards the bottom side. Lee Sin knows you can't really kick that gank off, unfortunately. So not going to fully commit just yet. But also, if you guys are not too familiar with this, these teams already have some history when it comes down to the Wild Rift Asia Brawl. They already played against each other in their second match of the tournament, and it was won, not dominantly, it was pretty damn close, but Mega Esport took this series 2-1 and did send next play in the loser bracket right away. So far, they know, but this is the next play. They came in prepared. They already played against their team. They know their playstyle. They know what they like to do, and they know their weaknesses also. So they are definitely going to try and potentially peek down on those weaknesses and try and get ahead if possible.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think as to allude to your River Scuttler point, yeah, I think at this stage of the game, you just want to make sure you get one of them. Like, getting double scuttled as a jungle, especially as a Lee Sin, that would feel really bad. So I think Lee Sin just said, look, let's not take any risks in our first game of the series. Let's not get into a crazy run it down coin flip level 3 brawl around the River Scuttler. I'm just going to go to the other side of the map and take the other one where we have a bit of prio in the bot lane. So they essentially used the prio that they had in the bot lane. You know, that Janna Kai'Sa generally tends to do okay into the Alistar gym. And so they just basically said, okay, let's go and grab the River Scuttler. But as you said, the Drake is spawning in the next minute. It is Infernal. This is a Drake that you generally tend to see teams put high priority on to contest, even in the early game. So you're expecting teams to sort of coordinate their back timings around this dragon. I am expecting a little bit of a fiesta around this dragon if we're going to have a fight breakout, because it is a very important dragon, especially dragons to give you some power in the late game. This is an engage, though.
Oh, Hextech Ultimatum under the tower. They're just going to go. Like, she finds a pick and a 1v2. Going to now put a focus down to the Camille. Camille gets a good extra bit of damage. But, man, that was an aggressive dive. But still, Arisen, OP as he is, comes out on top and picks up the very first blood of the game.
That was just an interesting dive. I felt very forced to me, especially the Hextech Ultimatum under the turret. I mean, Akali had just used her smokescreen. If she uses a smokescreen, you know it's going to be difficult for you to essentially find those executing blows on her. So very well played by Arisen, but honestly, overforced. The Infernal Drake is spawn as well.
Oh, the bot's going to be a big fight. Janna going to go for the ultimate, but in a lot of time, Lee Sin ready to join the fight. Up and in 3v3, currently 3v4. As Zed joins the mix. Good rotation from Chully to try and negate the fight. Now they're ready to go, but though Drake is on the board, and you said it here, Scandal, that's going to be the one they put a lot of focus onto if they can early on. Lee Sin ready to go for the dive and maybe smite it away. And unfortunately, he's not going to commit to it. Oh my god, he goes for it, but no Vi to secure it with her own smite, and that's going to be Lee Sin out of commission, eliminated almost instantly. But though they're going for the extra dive, Ketan Cool from the gym will come on through, gets nice extra damage. The burst comes on through, but Repos from the Fiora allows it to tank it up, and now they're all going down one by one. Omega Esports struggling, and next play taking their revenge.
That was a really, really big win for next play in the early game as well, because Infernal Drake is going to help you scale up. Let's take a look back at that replay. You'll notice Lee Sin essentially tries to go for the steal, and I don't blame him, because this is a really important dragon to try and contest for your team. And at this point forward, essentially you're just out of position. You've got the Fiora heal going through, just giving her a lot of extra sustain. And once Akali joins the fight, you've already taken way too much damage. You lost a member early on, so you essentially forced it into a 4v5. You were never really going to come out of that on top, but going 2 for 3 is not so bad if you're in Omega's position, but losing the Infernal Drake is definitely a bit of a pain.
Oh, Gank once again in the top side, man. Gank after Gank. Next play, they're looking for the fight, though the Stun Fire Star is going to be available, trying to make his way into tower. Does heal off of the Honey Fruit, but unfortunately he's going to be singled out, and Vi should be able to pick that one up with also the Lee Sin. Lee Sin's going to be getting that one for himself. The Ryzen, though, unfortunately taking a lot of damage. Great response coming on through from the side of Omega Esport. Also going to be trying to single out the Vi, and she's going to be in a world of trouble. Eliminated, picked up by the Camille. And man, the response, like, this is a very even game. Good play coming on through from both sides, but at the end, Omega Esport come out on top.
I mean, that was I think the dive was fine, by the way. I the dive was completely fine, but it just felt overforced. Yeah. Like, they had no vision. They had very little vision of the enemy red side jungle. They didn't pay attention to who was showing and who wasn't showing on the map. And it just felt like it was an overforced dive onto a Camille who's very good at negotiating dives in the first place. Going in for the Rift Herald again, this is just complete fiesta for neutral objectives right now.
And disaster's been behind. So much time that the smite comes off through from Lee Sin, but 2 frags picked up. Will it worth it? I'm not too sure about that one. Now it's going to be Kaiser. 3 frags for that one. That's a downfall, but next play that good. Disaster bought just so much valuable time, and then team just came on through three kills. Super worth it as they go for the tower.
It's really difficult in these games because, like, you really feel like at some point someone's going to take their foot off the pedal. I mean, these guys are running it down for the neutral objectives, just going into a full-on brawl every time a neutral objective becomes available. And right now it's next play who are coming out on top. I don't even think Zed has been joining these fights. It looks like Zed has just been casually splitting in the side lane right now. Again, they're going to want to transition into a 1-3-1 eventually. They've got a strong solo laner. They've got a 3-1-3 Akali, a 2-1-2 Zed. This is the perfect position. You've got the gold on the right champions. Your solo laners are in a strong position to be able to 1v1 the majority of the other champions in the game. But these 5v5 Fiesta brawls, they are just something else. I was not expecting, especially wasn't expecting next play to sort of go for them so aggressively, especially the Rift Herald when they picked up that first turret of the game already. Mm. But nonetheless, next play do come out on top. They are really just utilizing the fact that these scrappy skirmishes favor the likes of their Akali. You know, she wants to get into the middle of a scrappy skirmish, just, you know, at least pick off members who are a little bit out of position and blow them up. That's fine. That is fine for next play. They are happy to take that gold. They're happy to get the free wins in that case. And they put themselves in a strong position, because all they're going to do now is put their solo laners in separate lanes, search for 1v1s, draw attention away from the neutral objectives like the Drake, and hopefully coalesce and capitalize on that.
I do have to say that I've been reading the Trovo chat. A lot of people think they're like asking, what's the score? The game just started. This is game number one. It's 0-0. You guys have not missed anything, so you're good to go. But the Drake is going to be on the menu. It's going to be an Ocean Drake up in now 10 seconds. A little bit of vision going to be already put up there for Omega Esport, making sure it's not going to be contested. But really, I got to say, it feels good because next play, our team that really heavily relies on their rotation in the matches they won so far throughout the entire tournament. And it feels good to see a team here that has a response, though. Going to be potentially going for the Herald. Yeah, the Herald is indeed going to be popped into the mid lane. They want to try and get that first half. They can with the dive coming on through. The Root coming on through from Jin does not connect. Nice Ripos coming on from the Fiora. No, great knockup. A lot of CC coming on through, and that's going to be unfortunate for the sort of next play. They can't find it. As Akali trying to move away, the Zonya comes on through. Janna, great ultimate to single out this Vi. She's got the GA. She will get rezzed up. Can she survive, though? I'm not too sure about that one. She's going to be 1v4'd instantly, and she's taking an insane amount of damage, but actually potentially makes it out. No, she doesn't. The flash comes out, and that's going to be 1 and 2 out. Vi and Akali out of commission entirely. The Fiora will follow down. They're all so damn low, but they are why are they staying so long next to the tower? What's happening for their side? And a curtain call to close it off. He goes for the hit. It doesn't connect, but doesn't matter. Blue frags coming through, and next play dominates in the mid lane.
I don't even know what to analyze, Max. It's just a complete fiesta. I mean, they're just like, okay, meet you in mid at dawn, throw everything at each other, and just see who comes out on top. It doesn't really feel like there's a calculated gamble here. It's just like, okay, we think that we're stronger. No, wait, we think that we're stronger, and just go for the full-on team fight. I mean, it was obviously a good execute by Fiora at the very beginning to take out, they took out the Akali very early on, but then they just fought under tower for ages. We have another Fiesta, Max.
Another one, and this is going to be second Draco in the way of next play. They're off to a really good start. Lee Sin once again going to get battered and bullied out of this game entirely. And now it's time to chase. Camille got a lot of mobility. She's kind of just slip away of that engagement entirely. While Zed is really heavily committing to this one, truly a little bit over Nova extend. We'll be able to slip away, but two Drakes in a row, and they're going straight to the Baron because they picked up two frags. I mean, why not? They're so far ahead, they can afford to do it.
Yeah, I mean, obviously it's always a little risky. I mean, the Baron does deal a significant amount of damage. There is still a Camille alive. There is still a Kai'Sa. Like, if they get into the pit in the correct way, you could be spilling doom. You can see JLC just sitting on the sidelines here. No, they're not going to get there quick enough. And that's a huge amount of damage coming out. Truly on the Zed.
Oh, the shield comes on through on Stronger. He almost died to the ignite of Zed there, but that's not going to be happening. Truly not going to be bringing too much on the table in terms of fragging power, but that's okay. Still, in terms of gold lead, 43k up to 38k. That's going to be a good old 5k up to almost 6k gold lead going so far in favor of next play. And the tower game is also going their way so far. But game is, I got to say, next play are starting to run away with the lead, but I'm seeing also smart on this Camille that keeps on using the ultimate onto Horizon when he still hasn't used the smoke screen. Like, after he uses that, you just can't damage him. Camille should try and really focus another target, especially this Jhin. This so far in such a good spot. He's 5-0. You gotta cancel him out instantly.
I mean, I guess he's using the ultimate to try and limit the mobility of the Akali, because Akali would not be able to dash out of that ultimate. So maybe he's using it in a more defensive way to protect the Kai'Sa. And I do understand it from that perspective. But you are right. I think this Akali is too far ahead for you to be able to do that. It feels very difficult for you to just kind of just straight up say. But he goes on to the Jhin here. But I still don't think this is a great engage.
Good headbutt, trying to cancel out the ultimate of the Camille. She's going to get rooted down by the Jhin, and Jhin on the back line, not taking any damage. He's just having a fun time overall in this game. And the extra dive coming out, though three players still remaining for the site of Omega Esport. Can they defend the tower? They're going to give it a shot. Oh my god, the nice engage from this Alistar. Picks up the damage. The frags are flying by in the ways of next play. An extra few frags, and this Jhin is just disrupting the entire composition of Omega Esport. And now they're knocking on their door, knocking on the base, and taking down the Nexus Tower.
Yeah, they're going to go an easy Inhib tower here. That's a lot of damage coming out from the Lee Sin, but no one will drop Inhib at this stage in the game. Next play are absolutely in the driving seat. Big item spikes picked up as well. The Akali has got the Rabadon's death cap completed. Interesting that she didn't upgrade her nullifying orb into anything more, just wanted to go for the flat magic penetration. But this Akali is super scary. Zed has picked up the majority of his lethality and the last whisper. Even though there isn't a huge amount of armor for him to face down, he's still going to be shredding through that natural armor resistance that he's also facing. I've noticed that a disaster does this on Alistar a lot. Even if he's facing any kind of AP, he will always prioritize the Bramble Vest just to, you know, prevent and limit some of the healing, which is obviously going to be great versus the Blade of the Ruined King from the Kai'Sa. It's going to be great for the versus the Death's Dance of the Fiora. So he loves to do this. Just pick up that Bramble Vest. This is a good tip for anyone that's a support. And if your team's not buying any Grievous Wounds, just pick up a Bramble Vest. If they attack you, they're going to have a Grievous Wounds applied to them, and that's going to limit their healing overall. So this is something that I think Disaster does a lot in his games, and it works out well for him. You can now see that they've entered into a kind of a 1-4 split. Chuli's not overextending here, though. He's not going towards that second tier turret. I genuinely think he could have. The only reason I guess he's backed is to pick up that teleport, I believe. So he backed to pick up the teleport and actually wants to come join the fight for a 5v5. I don't blame them from opting out of a split push in this scenario, because I genuinely do believe they are just strictly stronger in a 5v5 at this point in time. They are absolutely crushing in the 5v5, so I suppose there is no real reason to risk a split push if you can actually just force the team fights and win anyway.
Yeah, especially when you got like a Camille on the other side. That's going to make matters a little bit worse if you get caught out. You can't really escape. So I do respect that decision to not go for it. But I'm also going to be seeing a Drake on the menu once again. It's going to be a Cloud Drake coming on through. But Zed maybe trying to single out this Fiora. But no, not going to be taking that fight once again. Being really, really respectful when it comes down to it. And the Baron is also going to be up on the Summoner's Rift extremely soon. So that's going to be something to keep in mind also. So far, also, the goal lead is still going at all-time high for next play. They are not giving up. They are not doing any mistakes whatsoever. And to make esports say, if they want to do a comeback, it is going to be mainly down to being able to single out one of those targets, but they can't do so as Vi. And also, the Jhin going to be now taking down this Drake and this no information, unfortunately, for the other side, and they just can't contest it.
Chuli here is going to back out. He's just a little shy of catching Lee Sin with his sweeper in that brush right now. But again, he's drawing attention to that side lane. Chuli does this a lot, especially when he plays the Zed. Draws attention to him so that the team can cross map onto something like the Baron or can cross map onto something like the Dragon. So you saw him in the top lane. He drew the Lee Sin and the Fiora up there. They cross mapped onto the Dragon. You can see him now heading towards the bot lane. They're going to do the same thing. They're going to group up for the Baron, and hopefully Chuli is attempting to draw attention to himself so that his team... Well, actually, let's just fight.
Oh, there you go. The Vi engages, and unfortunately, no GA for Lee Sin. He's going to be out instantaneously, and the fight just barely kicked off. They also proc the GA on top of the Kai, so she's going to be a casualty. Curtain call to try and finish off the fight for the Jhin. And even though they put so many resources, this is a pretty big dive, though. They're taking quite a significant amount of damage, but unfortunately, there's no response for Omega Esport. They already cracked on open the base earlier in the mid lane, and they're just waiting for the wave, and that should be all said and done. This should be indeed game number one for next play. They don't even need the wave. They just find the extra frag on top of the Kai'Sa, and they will try and close it off. Question mark? No, that's going to be Alistar taking his time, but the wave is just behind. It's just a matter of time before next play take the series 1-0.
Honestly, Max, usually I have quite a lot to break down in a game. Usually I will sit back and try and you know, specifically talk about moments in the game that were impactful. But this was a run it down for first Drake because it was Infernal Drake game, and the winner of that fight ended up dominating. It was just basically two very early team fights that were really, again, as I said in draft, neither of these comps are really designed for team fights. Neither of these comps have got like insane tools for team fights. But we talked about the fact that the next play had a slightly better edge when it came to playing the team fights correctly, because they had two assassins that could dive the backline, eliminate the Kai'Sa, eliminate the Janna, whatever you want to do. Mm-hmm. And it was a little harder for Omega to get their Fiora and their Camille into the backline and have the same kind of effect on the Jhin. So that those first two team fights that opened up, you saw that in action. Arisen and Chuli were just much more impactful at getting to the backline and actually having an impact compared to the Fiora and the Camille. And those two team fights unfortunately snowballed the game. It was essentially as simple as that. You had those two team fights just after the 7-minute mark, you know, or just before, sorry, just around 4 minutes, and obviously just at 7 minutes, and it started to snowball like crazy from that point onwards. So I think realistically, this is just this team ran it down at first Drake, and they came out on top.
Yeah, I mean, also the thing is, they have such a good dive composition for the set of next play, was that Alistar, the Zed, the Vi, the Akali, that they can't, when you're on side of Omega Esport, they can't just overlook like characters diving their backline, like the Kai'Sa, like this Vi, and even the Zed, and they're just like, we have to fix them down. But unfortunately, during that time, Uzi on the backline with this Jhin, this 8-0-14, by the way, the MVP of that game, he's just dashing out the damage. And when the fight is about to close off, they're like, okay, it's curtain call time. And he just tries to find a few picks. And even if he doesn't find a damage, he just applies the slow that makes matters even easier for his frontline to get those extra frags and proc the GAs if needed. So overall, I think it was just so well played from next play. I fully agree with what you're saying there, Excoundrel. There's not much to talk about other than next play just dominated. But one thing's for sure, every single game we're going to have today, we're going to have a Filipino win like every time. So yeah, it's still good. It's good.
It's Philippines versus Philippines right now. They've had a really good performance in this tournament. So, you know, if you're a Filipino fan, you're laughing because either of your teams are going to win in this scenario. One of the other things that is worth noting as well about the team comps is that, you know, if you are diving as Fiora and Camille onto the back line, onto the Jhin, then you are just exposing your Kai'Sa and Janna to an incredibly threatening double assassin dive, as well as the single target lockdown of the Vi. So just compositionally, I don't really think the Omega wanted a team fight. Like, I think they wanted to transition into the split push. They wanted to transition into Fiora in the bot lane, Camille in the Baron lane, or whatever. You know, you can switch that around. But they got baited by the Inferno. Like, you know, and we've seen teams ignore Drakes at the start and win, with a Fiora especially. The biggest example that comes to mind is 16-bit. They ignored the first two Drakes of the game and took towers on the other side of the map and used that global gold to accelerate their split push tactics. But this team, you know, Omega just felt that they wanted to fight for it because it was Inferno. And I don't blame them. Inferno is a strong Drake, but you don't need to take that Drake fight every single time. And obviously, we saw Next Play capitalize on that.